Hi, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to today's workshop, How to Build an Impact Ecosystem. My name is Ellis Watominuk. I use he, him pronouns. I am a Caucasian male with bleach blonde hair and a checkered shirt in front of a blurred Zoom background. I am the senior director of RARE's Entertainment Lab. RARE is a behavior change organization in climate and conservation. And the Entertainment Lab works with Hollywood to put high-impact, climate-friendly behaviors on screen and infuse behavioral science insights and research into impact campaigns, cause marketing, and PR. I'm also a former impact producer. Over 10 years ago, I had the honor of working on a documentary called Blackfish, which not only opened my eyes to the power of storytelling, but helped change public perception around marine animals in captivity and led to policy change at the state and federal level here in the United States. It was, without a doubt, one of the proudest moments of my career, and also what I like to think will keep me safe during what appears to be a global orca uprising. So orcas, if you're listening, we are hashtag Team Orca here. In all seriousness, this change did not happen in a vacuum. Team Orca was quite large. It was built with the hard work of activists, nonprofits, policymakers, which is precisely why we're here today. Storytelling has immense power to drive social change. That's undeniable, but the world is complex and people are complex. And sometimes storytelling alone is not enough. The most effective change happens when you bring together the inherent power of storytelling with an impact ecosystem. So that's what we plan to do today, to really examine how content and impact producing can work together to drive social change and demonstrate best practices. As a former impact producer, I know the field of social impact work is underfunded and under-resourced, but vital. Measurement and evaluation can help impact producers and teams understand how to most effectively leverage your projects and use these limited time and resources. Part one of today's workshop, we will dive into the power of storytelling through audience measurement and evaluation. That will be led by RARE's Dr. Anirudh Tavatia and Laurel Tamayo. And part two, we'll continue that conversation to look at how we can understand the impact ecosystem and measure that infrastructure. That'll be presented by Sam Adler from Exposure Labs. Please continue to drop your questions and comments in the chat, and at the end, we'll have a brief Q&A. So with that said, I will turn it over to Dr. Anirudh Tavatia to lead us through the first part of this workshop.
Hello, I am Dr. Anirudh Tavatia. I am Indian, so I'm dark-skinned, wearing an orange shirt with a background that is a photograph of the New York Public Library art and architecture wing. So a beautiful library if you've been there. And my pronouns are he, him. Okay, so I sort of want to start by acknowledging that we tell stories for a lot of reasons. I mean, everyone on this call knows this, right? We want to entertain. We want to sort of capture the current moment. We want to imagine different realities. We want to escape. We want to be seen. We want to show that what is hidden. I mean, there's just an endless list. Within that sort of endless list, there is a subsection that is explicitly trying in its aims to impact audiences in a way that inspires them to take action, right? That tries to bring about change. So for the next 20 minutes, I'm going to try and focus on this smaller subset of stories. And the reason I'm focusing on that is not because the other ones don't matter, but I'm simply not, as a behavioral scientist, competent to talk about them, right? Okay. So let's start by acknowledging the scale of the problem, right? Stories can inspire, they can bring about change, but behavior change is also really hard. And not all behaviors are created equal. Right, changing trends on fashion might not be the same as getting someone to do the ice bucket challenge, which is not the same as trying to get someone to give up their favorite hamburger. Behaviors where rewards are immediate and costs are distant, and they can be distant psychologically or emotionally or literally physically distant or temporally distant. In all of those cases, it's particularly hard to get people to change behavior. And if we acknowledge that, what we realize is that not all behaviors will respond to similar pathways for change. So when we think about impact, how do we amplify impact? Well, it might help if we take a brief moment to just get a little bit more formal on our theories of how content impacts people's willingness to take action. So this model, I think everybody knows, right? This is the sort of beginning model. It's I call it the inspiration model. It's kind of a content focused model. And then it says something like, you know, you watch an inspiring piece of content, amazing imagery, beautiful dialogue, compelling narrative. And, you know, all of that leads to a burst of issue awareness, a sense of issue importance. Things feel suddenly way more urgent, maybe hopeful, and they feel personally relevant, right? And we think that those things then increase our motivation, increase our emotional engagement, they increase our empathy, they increase how much we self-identify with the with the issue at hand, and all of that drives behavior change. This model actually reminds me of a story that Julia Olson, who is the architect behind the Held v. Montana climate case, in case you have heard of that, the one fighting for all of our rights through the judicial system on behalf of young people in Montana. She sort of describes this moment, 2006, summer heat, she's pregnant, she's sitting in a theater, and she watches An Inconvenient Truth, just starts bawling, and, you know, decides she's going to change her life and focus on using law to fight against climate chaos. That's a, you know, it's the lightning in the bottle. It's the thing that we you know, it's the most intoxicating model. It's also probably among the more rare ways in which content changes people, because it needs to catch the right person at exactly the right time with exactly the right tone. And that coincidence of factors is just not as common as we would like it to be. So with that said, let's try and think of what another model might be. Okay, so a second model, and one that I think also most people here are familiar with, would be something like, you know, content changes social norms, and that's our sort of pathway to changing behavior. So content exposes you to new types of behavior, there's a dialogue that sort of references it, their characters model that on screen, people at home start seeing this behavior as more common, more frequent, more normal, more expected, and more socially rewarded. In some, they suspect that norms around them are changing because of what they're seeing on screen. And because we know norms drive behavior, this change in perceived norms leads to a change in behavior. And, you know, I think the most famous example that we all sort of know is the example of the drunk driving campaign in the 1980s involving, oh, sorry, could you go back one? Yeah, so you know, and in that model, you sort of had the same kind of idea where, you know, big shows like Cheers and Dallas and LA Law have multiple moments where they're exposing people to dialogue, to scenes, to behavior modeling. They're rewarding them. And the our telling of the story goes something like this, that, you know, people watch this on screen, they became familiar with designated driving, and they suspected that the norms were changing, and they started adopting the norms. We enter a virtuous cycle, and, you know, drunk driving fatalities go down. I think the story might be a slightly more nuanced. And so if you'd go to the next slide, Alice. Yeah, I think there's there's something of value in actually diving into that campaign and understanding exactly how they did pull off this miracle. Of dramatically reducing drunk driving fatalities. And the lesson from history is that content shapes social norms, but it also is that it only works within or it often needs an entire ecosystem to help support that. So one, I suspect this model only works when you have large-scale media saturation. Now, I want to flag Rare's Entertainment Lab is spending a lot of effort in this model of how content can change social norms. We believe in it. We think it's a really important model. I think many people at the Hollywood Climate Summit are working to try and get these sort of moments on screen in order to sort of shape an entire media ecosystem. But to give you the sense of the scale, 160 shows had mentions of drunk driving and included that in their plots. All three major broadcasters had coordinated PSA campaigns during primetime repeatedly. Harvard led a massive PR campaign. The estimate was $100 million a year in free media donation to the campaign. In addition, well before this began, there was a whole bunch of community organizing that happened, right? That brought the idea and the issue to people's importance, that made people care about it. That same community organizing also gained legislative power. They changed the laws. By 1984, you wouldn't get federal money for your highways unless the age for drinking was 21 and not 18. In terms of drunk driving enforcement, cops became way more serious about enforcing drunk driving. Courts became way more serious about penalizing people who were caught for it. Businesses became liable. And then, in addition to all of that, there were prominent champions, two or three presidents, Bill Clinton among them, governors, the major sports leagues, the MLB, the list goes on. The point being that this was, content did help shape norms, but it did so in an ecosystem that surrounded it with the ability to have content shape those social norms. Okay. So that was all an example to try and sort of sketch out what might be a potential third model for how content can impact people's behavior, right? So there's, instead of content going directly into changing norms and issue awareness, which is one pathway, content may also just open people up to the persuasive messaging from others, right? In fact, this reminds me of a moment from Wednesday night when Zoanne Clark, a writer on Grey's Anatomy, brought up the fact that when they bring up health issues on their shows, they have a sort of Twitter post with more details that comes right after the show, that's like launched alongside the content, in order to help. And what she said was that, you know, we don't expect the show to do everything. What we hope is that it inspires people enough to go and look at that other stuff, right? And so this is this kind of content as opening people to persuasive messaging from others. And then as long as there is that relevant other who is providing that persuasive messaging, we could imagine people move down the pipeline. They become open to efficacy-based messaging. And then if there's campaigns that boost people's ability to act, both perceived and real, you kind of move them along into willingness to consider that behavior. And then if there are other campaigns that provide opportunities to act and reduce friction, you get change in behavior. So if you take this model seriously, what that means is the content is the first in a coordinated sequence of messages that must work together as a infrastructure of impact, an ecosystem of impact that helps the content on screen yield behavior at home. Okay, so I'm gonna give you an example because that felt very sort of abstract. And I'm gonna sort of use Grey's Anatomy. Big shout out to my colleague, Emily Corrin, for pointing this one out to me, and Shondaland for being amazing during the election campaigns and using these tools incredibly well. So imagine a moment in Grey's Anatomy where a character votes and they get shown voting, and then they put the sticker "I voted" on their scrubs, right? A simple model would be like, oh, I saw someone vote, and then I see a change in norms, and so now I'm gonna consider voting. I don't think very many people are gonna follow that pathway, but imagine a different world where someone watches that show and a Get Out the Vote organization uses that moment to text message the people on their mailing list and reference the show and provide a voter registration link. Or on Facebook, your friend references that show and puts that voter registration link. You're suddenly, because of your exposure in the show, more likely to click on that link. Now, once you've clicked on that link, a second organization starts working with you to help find your polling site and help you figure out how to plan how to get to your polling site. So that gets you to the space of consideration. And then a third organization, or they can be the same one, but three separate campaigns, then works to provide transportation on voting day from underserved communities to polling sites, whether that's from churches or from neighborhoods. And then we get a change in behavior, right? If you think about that, that's a very long sequence of coordinated activity. Now, the good news is people are doing this. They're doing this in the Get Out the Vote campaigns all the time. And so we can build similar things within the climate space. Okay. What does that actually mean if you take this seriously? It means entertainment content is the first in a sequence of activations or messages. It means that questions come up, like how do you best leverage the on-screen handoff? How many touch points do you need? What order do they need to appear in? What is the cadence that they need to have? And what's the timing that they need to be sequenced in? And this is where measurement and evaluation can help. So let me sort of give you a brief overview of where M&E can fit in. So one version of this is sort of an upstream focus, where we examine how sort of different content impacts people differently and support editorial decisions on the creation side, right? There's a downstream moment, which is once it's in the can we study how it impacts audiences, provide that information and to the right people and support the strategic design of impact campaigns. There's a third version, which is sort of the dream. It's already done in now, I think, in sort of the democratic space, but it would be a dream to sort of start doing this here, which is that as you're doing your impact campaign, there's kind of iterative live testing where different messaging and outreach strategies are sort of being measured on the fly, and that's being used to support the operational implementation of the impact campaign. And then the last one is that when you're done, if you design the campaign for successful postmortems from the beginning, it helps you draw lessons for the future, because let's be honest, every campaign is just one in a sequence of campaigns. And so supporting future planning and strategic growth is key. And we're very lucky to have Sam on here to talk more about sort of that space. Okay, to get away from the abstraction, we decided to run a case study. This is downstream. Madam Secretary was already in the can. So what we did was we wanted to understand how exposure to climate forward content impacts audiences and how long that potential impact persists for. And then we wanted to sort of use this as a proof of concept to show, to share with people that this can in fact be done on the cheap. Not the cheap, but it can be done on a reasonable budget. And that if you do it, that it can potentially be used to really inform impact campaign design and implementation in a way that helps you allocate those scarce resources more optimally, right? Because we don't have infinite budgets. So knowing what will and will not work is very helpful in making sure that we spend our limited resources optimally. So to just give you a backstory, the Madam Secretary episode involves a super typhoon, which is on course to destroy the island state or the island nation of Nauru. And Elizabeth McCord, the Secretary of State, and her team have to figure out how to evacuate the people and permanently relocate the entire population. So it touches on really key themes, extreme weather. It talks about how climate is impacting that extreme weather. It talks about vulnerable communities, specifically vulnerable nations, climate migration, and the fact that when these events happen, a lot of people will be left dispossessed. They will be left stateless, and other countries and the global community will have to act. So really powerful messaging. And in addition, it is fast-paced, it's entertaining, it has witty dialogue. So it was sort of a great stimulus for our case study.
And this was taken above the monsoon trough by our new GOES 18 satellite. Maps are like rashes. If it's big, if it's red, it's probably bad.
Yeah, I'm getting hives just looking at it.
Here's a patch of superheated ocean. Rising temperatures are outpacing even our worst-case models, so tropical cyclogenesis is going to get more frequent, more destructive.
So Blessing isn't a freak, it's the new normal.
Well, there was a time when we couldn't link specific storms to climate change, but that time has passed. Which brings us to Nauru. The survivors need to leave now.
You mean until they rebuild?
No. I mean permanently.
Hang on. You want an entire people to just pack up and leave?
Like walls.
I have a suspect that the video has stopped, but I think people probably got the sense of the content.
Walls, dikes, levees, we have ways of fighting rising sea levels.
Well, with bedrock, maybe, but this island's built on soft coral. Another high frequency wave event could be
devastating.
Yeah. It's like a tsunami hitting a sandcastle. And given the data, the odds of that happening in the near future are too high for comfort.
Okay, so I think you got a sense of the show. And then let me just give you a very brief outline for how this worked. We recruited audiences online, about 1,000 of them. And we shared the link to the episode using a sort of digital platform, and then measured audiences at 4 points in time. Now, crucially, audiences were either randomly assigned to watch this climate episode, or just the episode right prior, which has to do with Afghanistan and has absolutely nothing to do with climate whatsoever. So, you know, same sort of show, same kinds of characters, same kinds of dialogue. One has a climate focus, one has not. So it's an ideal way to be able to sort of do a comparative analysis. We measure everyone at baseline. We measure them immediately after they watch the content. We measure them 3 days after watching the content. We measure them 10 to 15 days after watching the content. The reason we're doing all these multiple ways, by the way, is because we want to try and also, as part of this case study, put into people's head the idea that there may be decay functions. I'll talk about it later, but that's sort of a foreshadowing. And we measured a whole battery of sort of psychosocial predictors of action, as well as targeted questions designed for the content specifically. I just want to flag here, the goal here isn't, does Madam Secretary work, right? Like quote unquote. That's not the goal of why we're sharing this. The goal here is to use this as a proof of concept, outline a playbook for how you could do this with research, how you could do this on a small budget with content that matters to you, and how the output could be used to support an integrated transmedia multi-channel messaging strategy, right? That's our goal. Okay. So what did we find? Exposure to the content increased worry. The blue dots, by the way, here are the climate episode. The red dots are the control episode, and it goes from left to right on sort of a 0 to 100 scale. So if something is further to the right, that means we increased it on that variable, right? So you see that those little bars show you like sort of our uncertainty. And so we're relatively certain that in fact, being exposed to this content increases people's worry about the climate. It also increases their perceptions of threat severity, right? They are more likely to think that climate change is not just real, but it is an urgent matter. Importantly, it moved support for not just government action on climate change, but strong government action on climate change, which was really nice, right? And makes sense given the cadence of that show itself. And then it's sort of boosted a slew of sort of climate justice policies, which is really neat because the show focuses on a Pacific Island nation. This is normally removed. We don't think about this. And if we're gonna have any shot at sort of having a just climate transition, we need to be able to get people thinking about unequal consequences, right? And the one that I'm most excited about is that one right at the bottom, which is that there was a huge jump in people's willingness to say that high polluting countries like the United States should compensate vulnerable countries. If you'll notice that red dot, I mean, support for that is normally essentially near zero. Being able to move, I mean, those are in psychology, those are huge effects, right? Like that's really, really dramatic. But then a bunch of other climate justice policies also moved, right? Like willingness to accept climate migrants, willingness to provide emergency aid, which is the line above that. Alice, if you'd click. And And, you know, the willingness to create a resilience fund. The big takeaway here is, you know, a bunch of things moved, but the key things are worry and threat severity moved, support for climate action moved, and support for specific climate justice policies moved. Okay. Now, I just covered this sort of like the key insights there for support for government action and policies. But what also moved actually was people's sort of sense that like, hey, taking climate action is the right thing to do, and that institutions, if they work together, can actually make an impact. Now, what did not move was trust in government, trust that governments will do anything about the climate, self-efficacy, people's belief that they can take action and it matters, or collective efficacy, which is if we work together, we can make a difference. Okay, so normally at this point, when I'm sort of done with this kind of research, what we would do is we would try and transfer these insights over to a impact producer so that they can then use them along with all the other information that they have to try and sort of develop a strategic plan for their impact strategy. Luckily, we have someone in-house. We have a team in-house that does that, and my colleague Laura is on the call, so I'll sort of hand it over to her to give you an example for how this could be used.
Thanks, Anirudh. Hi, everyone. My name is Laurel Tamayo. I use she, her pronouns. I'm a Southeast Asian woman with medium length black hair and a blazer. As an impact producer, this data is super useful in creating an impact campaign strategy to figure out what action or change we'd like to inspire in the audience. Data would suggest that the show is not ideal for encouraging individual action because self-efficacy was not moved and motivation to act was not moved. Because of that, I wouldn't leverage the content to heavily promote any calls to actions around individual action to tackle climate change. However, these insights provide a lot of other useful information. We can see that there are gains in desire for strong government action, significant climate justice policies, and belief that institutions together can make a difference. And there is, however, that vital gap that we need to fill, which is trust in government. So to start off with what did move, that was increased support for government action and climate justice policies. So this is an opportunity to educate the audiences further. In past impact campaigns that I've worked on, like for the film I Am Greta about Greta Thunberg, we created a website with discussion guides. And so we could do the same for this episode. We could have examples of past climate policies that have worked. And we can also highlight organizations like Citizens Climate Lobby that is currently doing this work, even stories of individuals in these organizations and what brought them here, because that could inspire the audience. Maybe they'll find a connection through that. As an impact producer, the gap that we need to fill would signal the need to bring in trusted, relatable messengers like community leaders to help demonstrate that governments can act in public interest. I can imagine a screening tour of the campaign that would bring together community leaders, grassroots organizers, and local businesses that have already built trust with communities on panels with like government and policymakers to rebuild that trust and really create space for audiences to share their demands for climate policy. And I will pass it back to you, Anirudh.
Yeah, thank you. I really like that. I think that would be like a amazing sort of integration, right? If you can fill that gap for trust in government, then all these boosts in sort of policy support could really make a difference. Okay, so the last thing I want to touch on is this idea of a decay function. So what are decay effects and why are they important? I think the easiest way to sort of translate this is COVID vaccines. You know, when you take them, they work for a little while, and then after a while, they don't work quite as well. And different COVID vaccines have different decay functions. So understanding a decay function would be super critical in being able to help understand when the next sequence of steps needs to happen. So if you, again, keep using this COVID vaccine analogy, we sort of know that, you know, you have to have your first one on day one, and then the second one 2 weeks later. And we know because there's a particular decay function and a dose response, and that if we sort of time those things correctly, we can stabilize an effect. Okay, that's the metaphor and that's the sort of mental model. I would like to sort of share as an analytic framework that you can use for content, which is when people are exposed to content, things move, but they don't move forever. People start returning back to baseline. They exist in a world, they're constantly being exposed to content. We live in a world of constant stimulus. And so part of how MNE can help here is try and start quantifying what kind of decay function we will have. And these are going to be different for different types of shows, and they're going to be different for different types of variables, right? But if we can get more precise about that, what that tells us is how much time do we have between message one and the next sequence in message? And what kind of message can we send that the next sequence that can kind of stabilize that decay function? Some of these can be fast, right? So Madam Secretary, we started seeing decline in gains even after 3 to 5 days. That's that graph up there is a support for climate migrant, like accepting climate migrants over time. In blue, you see that climate episode really boosted that support from something like 25 to, you know, 45. And then it starts shrinking, right? And in 3 days, that dropped by 4 points. And we'll let you know what happens in 15 days. But the point is, knowing that information can help a campaign strategist and think about what is the right sort of sequencing. Okay, so just to sum up, you know, the thing I would love for you to take away here is that understanding how content impacts audiences can be a critical input in the strategic planning for impact campaigns. It'll help you figure out where the opportunities are, where is the content working, and what approaches might be most successful in leveraging those. It also is super helpful in figuring out what the gaps are, what is needed to translate the emotion that we get when we watch content into action. And again, I think we have to, would you mind moving to I forgot to mention. So the one thing I did want to highlight is that this doesn't have to be expensive. We did a sort of very large scale thing, and we did it because we wanted it to be super robust, and we're trying to measure decay functions, and we're trying to do it with the kind of scientific scrutiny that can submit to peer review. If you just wanted to do this to inform a campaign, you could do it with about 300 people online at an overall cost of something like $4,000 to $6,000 for very, very robust results. So don't think that this is something that only large budget studios can do. Okay, so I want to end with saying audience insights are only one input. If you take what we've been saying seriously, the content is only the first part. There's a sequence of messaging. And so measurement-driven strategy must also understand the players that serve as the infrastructure of an impact campaign, understand how the content plugs into existing efforts, serves in their needs on the ground, figures out who we can engage early, what support they need, and how does that content support the player's mission so we can get mission alignment, and what is the sequence so that we can make handoffs between teams seamless. If we don't have a research strategy that does that second part, then audience insights are going to be deeply hampered. Like they're going to be insufficient. Thankfully, we have Sam from Exposure Labs to take the baton from me and talk a lot more and with great experience about this second part of sort of understanding the infrastructure.
Awesome. Thank you, Anaru, and thanks, Laurel. My name is Sam Adler. I am the Senior Impact Manager at Exposure Labs. I go by she, her pronouns. I am a Caucasian woman with long brown hair, a black button up, and I'm in front of a blurry kitchen background. And I'm really excited to share a little bit more about the work we do and the importance of infrastructure M&E and how that works in tandem with the metrics that Anaru and Laura just highlighted. So a little bit more about Exposure Labs for y'all who aren't familiar. We are a film and impact production studio behind the projects like The Social Dilemma, Chasing Coral, and Chasing Ice. And like most people in this room, we believe that storytelling has the power to change the way we see the world. So today I'm going to be talking about why we should be investing in infrastructure M&E, and then after that, do an overview of our film Chasing Corals impact campaign and how infrastructure evaluation helped us determine lessons that then informed our future climate programming and our short form content production and impact activities. So first, just want to break it down a little bit and define some of the jargon we're using. So why is infrastructure important? As Anirudh hinted at, it allows more informal impact measures, working alongside key players in your issues area, movement to understand how content resonated with communities and increase the efficacy of their work, and to understand better how your work fits within the overall movement space. And it allows us to give a shine to the legacy and experience and knowledge of movement leaders that are working on similar issue areas. And what are we talking about when we say infrastructure? It's a fancy way of accounting for everyone working towards the same issue area that your content is, versus solely talking to a target audience. A few ways that investing in infrastructure measurement can lead to getting an analysis of content and your campaign's role in the field, so you're not designing in a bubble, not reinventing the wheel, and taking into account the long-term work of movement spaces, so working alongside movement leaders to move the needle, designing impact activities to align with identified movement priorities and input, so again, working alongside those players in an infrastructure, building trust within movement leaders as an inherent result of working in this way, and creating more evergreen campaigns. So when you create something that is usable and increases capacity for movement leaders that you're working with, your campaign will go longer and have a longer lifespan.
Most people stare up into space with wonder. Yet we have this almost alien world on our own planet, just teeming with life. It's a world completely out of sight and out of mind.
I have the utmost respect for corals. They're really sophisticated animals.
Coral is a fundamental part of a huge ecosystem.
They continue living as long as their environment allows them to.
There's this big heat wave that's traveling around all over the world. The coral bleaches, and what you're seeing is its skeleton underneath. It's like your body temperature changing. That's the seriousness of the issue. So we're sending two teams to put cameras down and capture this bleaching event.
The wind and the storm is really the controlling factor right now.
The wind just took us. The stern anchor didn't hold.
It's just demolished. You're working in an environment every single day that humans weren't built for. Your body is cut up. And then you open your eyes. And it's dead as far as you can see.
We don't have any time to waste if we want to have any hope.
We live at a unique moment in time where we can change history. It's not too late for coral reefs.
This has got to wake up the world.
Awesome. So wanted to share the trailer for those who aren't familiar with the film, just so you get a kind of idea of what the content, what the story is about. But yeah, for our Chasing Coral Impact campaign, we really wanted the film to reach a global audience to raise awareness and then go deep with local communities to build political will for climate. So here are a few photos of that campaign and screenings across the US and the world. Our approach was to distribute the film through a robust screenings program paired with campaign activities that were armed with supplementary screening materials and education materials that made the experience, we hoped, easier for hosts and helped guide conversations to connect the dots from themes in the film to what's happening in communities' backyards. This approach led to thousands of screenings around the world, from beach communities to screenings in churches to corporate offices, you name it. In addition to the global campaign, we also ran several localized targeted campaigns to use the film as a tool for climate action and build political will around climate initiatives. So this involved partnering with climate organizations who had the knowledge about organizing around local political landscapes. One example here is the Dear South Carolina tour, where we worked alongside the conservation voters of South Carolina to organize screenings using Chasing Coral and other climate films across the state to build support for local climate elections coming up. And at these screenings, audience members wrote messages of support to their local elective officials for climate policies. And that following year, the Energy Freedom Act was passed, which was a landmark solar bill in the state. Well, we're so proud of the Chasing Coral campaign and its many successes, including an incredible number of screenings, and the Chasing Coral community, which is still very much alive, filled with people who are so passionate about ocean conservation and really carry the message of the film forward. We did learn a lot when we invested in infrastructure metrics by talking with movement leaders in the climate space and climate justice space. That actually helped to pivot our work for future climate programming. So the way that we did that is that we held conversations with people who worked in the space through impact surveys from our localized campaigns and participating in movement building spaces where we could have conversations with people who worked on the issue from multiple angles. Some lessons we learned, which were really helpful, was working alongside movement leaders from the get-go in designing the impact strategy. And, you know, the way that we learned one pivot, which was really interesting, is I stepped into a movement building space, into a room full of climate organizers and climate justice organizers, and presented the Dear South Carolina case study. And the way that I presented it, you know, we talked about the Energy Freedom Act, and I was actually corrected that there had been people who were working on this for decades and from many different angles. So it was a good reminder that it's important to work alongside and follow the leadership of movement leaders to understand the full landscape analysis. The second is that movement leaders know what's up, and storytelling is often a tool that fits their experience and their strategy. So making sure that it's designed in a way that they can carry on the work to further foster that, that infrastructure of moving the needle. And one thing that was flagged is that outside the big public wins and the number of screenings, that actually one of the impacts was that this model helped build capacity among organizations. So sometimes they didn't have to send that extra staff member, or the film could take the place of a panelist, et cetera, which was an important learning. And the last is that by attending these movement building spaces, we learned so much, like that first point I mentioned. And through casual conversations, we were able to understand, get more of an analysis, see what people are working on, where the gaps are. And just one note that these spaces are really meant to build community, and that it's an opportunity to build trust, but that there is, you know, one flag is that stepping in and out can be extractive, but by long-term investing in showing up in those spaces, it can go a long way. These learnings were key in pivoting the design of our future climate programming and short form content. With infrastructure metrics and input from these key partners in climate organizing space, we could better design programs that supported their existing work and build a more integrated impact strategy. After gathering learnings from organizations and movement leaders, we really wanted to ground our future work in long-term partnerships and trust building. And work alongside a partner who really had an understanding from the field and a really good understanding of where the work was going. In 2020, we kicked off a virtual Earth Day webinar with the Southeast Climate and Energy Network. This is a network that holds over 80 climate organizations working in the Southeast on climate and climate justice issues. This event led to us launching an RFP, or request for proposals, in partnership with the network called Film in the Field. The program was designed around a library of climate-related films, including Chasing Coral, and dispersing mini-grants to a cohort of about 7 network members to use a film within their programming. And the program was actually framed as a pilot with the purpose of continuing to gather those infrastructure metrics so then we could be more iterative as we continue to build the program alongside this partner. Grantees works range from organizations gathering their members together around a film to write letters to local officials, raising awareness around sea level rise in Florida, creating a platform for local indigenous groups to speak on climate issues, and more. By building this along the SEND team and an advisory board made up of network members, which was super key, we were able to design a program that could have a substantial impact and a tool that worked for the organizers' existing climate strategy. From the inception of Film in the Field, we really wanted to build in measures to gather those infrastructure metrics. As we said, it was a pilot program. We really wanted to invest in figuring out how we could be iterative and how storytelling could be used as a tool for network members. And the way that we did this, as Anuru mentioned, it doesn't have to cost $1 million. We did this in a very informal way to reiterate. So we did this through the advisory board, which was really key, made up of network members who could help guide us. Impact surveys packaged with screening kits for audience members that organizers and grantees could disperse. Impact surveys for the organizations themselves to see what was useful, and regular check-ins with SEND. Some of the lessons we learned was simple goes farther. So kind of a carryover from Chasing Coral, but these toolkits that were PDFs that are over designed sometimes were not the best for organizers. Instead, we created these really beautiful Google Docs that they can just take pieces that worked for their work instead of what we assumed. The second was clear and transparent decision-making for trust building. So that came along with the advisory board, who helped us create a really transparent criteria for grantees, and the same for every single decision point in the program. One interesting learning is that a lot of events actually focused around activating an existing base. So this was in the time of deep COVID and everything was virtual. So the storytelling was really a tool for organizers to bring people together. And the last, which is a biggie, is that organizers continued to reiterate that they were interested in how to tell their own stories. Stories from the South are not often uplifted. And they saw us as a way, as someone who could help them do that. And we're proud to say that these learnings inspired a second RFP where selected organizers were granted to tell their own stories through film. The infrastructure metrics gathered allowed us to plan this iterative program and be able to pivot with the feedback that organizers were giving us on what would be the most useful to move the needle on climate justice issues in the Southeast. The grant cycle ends this fall, and we're super excited to see what the learnings are so we can better support organizers in telling their stories and how to support the impact of those stories getting out into the world. The shorts range from explanatory videos meant to be a tool for the movement as we step into global spaces to retrospective pieces to uplift the work done by frontline organizers. And these infrastructure metrics from Chasing Coral's impact campaign and Film in the Field inspired Exposure Labs to invest in short form content centered around stories with movement leaders that they identified as the most important. In 2022, we brought on a short form team, and I'll shout out Carrie Pang and Josh Clark, who worked closely with our impact team, myself, to create short films to serve the field. One goal informed by infrastructure measures is that the short form production would allow us to have a faster turnaround time. So as y'all know, features can take years, and this allowed us to move at the pace of the movement and better respond to what movement leaders were saying are urgent issues. The model of our short form strategy bakes in impact and previous infrastructure metrics from the beginning. Working in partnership with movement leaders where we develop content based on the needs that they uplift and allows that iterative model where we can continue to work in a cyclical fashion, baking in learnings as we go. We're really excited to keep using that to create integrated impact campaigns for these models and distribution plans, which we see working hand in hand, which will be individual depending on each content. Right now, we've wrapped production on two films in our short form series, Climate Winds, a series about winds in the US South, where organizers self-nominated stories they see as the most urgent, interesting, joyful, et cetera. As part of this process, we're placing these shorts in local Southern film festivals, which we learned from chatting with protagonists and continuing to gather those metrics that it was important that we interacted with the local communities and gave a little shine in a moment versus stepping into those bigger film festivals. After those festivals, we'll be seeking wider distribution to displace the dominant narrative of who a climate activist is and lifting up the voices of frontline organizers that are featured in the film. And we wanted to share a little sneak peek of our first, which is Garden Ministry, featuring the amazing Reverend Dallas Conyers.
I grew up in Brooklyn, New York. I love the diversity of people. What I did not love was all the pollution that I didn't know was killing me. It wasn't until I started working full-time in the climate world that I realized that I was a product of an environmental justice community. Climate has a label of, I'm a tree hugger. Let's protect the riverbanks and the beds and the oceans. They're not talking about how all these polluting facilities and black and brown people are literally slow killing us and closing off our possibilities of excelling in life. Looking at that, I saw oppression in an entirely different way.
Thanks, y'all, and excited to talk about how infrastructure and audience metrics can work together, and I'll pass it over to Ellis.
Thank you, Sam and Honoré de Mauro. What an incredible conversation. I will invite you all to quickly turn on your cameras just for a rapid fire 5-minute Q&A. You know, thank you to the audience, by the way, for bearing with my tricky Wi-Fi. I think that's a good sign that we all need to kind of work together, right, and overcome these challenges. But so thanks for bearing with me. Honored, we had one question. I'll direct the first one to you. We had one question. You had used the words upstream and downstream to refer to the work and the case study that we did around Madam Secretary. We have an audience member who would like to know a little bit more upstream and what that means. Oh, and you might need to turn your mic on.
Great, thank you. Yeah, upstream is just sort of building in the research process into the content creation decisions, especially key decision points that, and you know, the industry has been doing this for a while in terms of trying to figure out like optimal endings or whatever, right? Like they, this is not an unheard of approach. We're piloting something where we're sort of trying to show, we're testing whether just digitally inserting solar panels into content and passive viewership can have an impact. Like if the results of that are promising, you can imagine being able to pass that upstream to when people are choosing scouting locations, or they can just put a prop solar panel on the roof and then, you know, sort of alter their content decisions and in sort of big ways and small. I just gave an example of the smaller ones, but.
Great, thank you. And since we have 3 minutes left, if we could just maybe do a quick rapid fire, and Sam and Laura, I'd particularly love to hear from you. I think a recurring theme from the day one of the Hollywood Climate Summit was just how much money and resources big oil and gas is funneling into their own sort of propaganda campaign, let's call it what it is. Impact producers are a vital piece of the climate movement. And so I'm curious kind of what, for maybe folks who are new to the space of impact producing, what are some best practices that you want to keep in mind, or are there places that you go to learn from movement leaders, from other impact producers? What would you give to someone getting started in the space? Sam, maybe I'll start with you and then Laurel.
Yeah, that's an important question. My advice would be, and it's a simple, maybe frustrating one, is to listen. I think there's so much value in stepping into spaces and hearing what movement leaders and grassroots organizations are already working on. And you'll be surprised how much synergy there is there. But yeah, there are convenings, and I'd say start looking at like local coalitions in the areas that you're working in, whether it's national, whether it's regional, and really putting an ear to the ground to see what the urgent measures they're working on. Oftentimes in those coalition and network spaces, people have already come together to work on something and you're just one more piece of the puzzle. So that would be my advice.
Going off of just like the idea of listening, that's also something that we kind of had to like learn to do and pivot when doing the Can You Hear Us campaign for the I Am Greta film. I remember one thing was we partnered with the Helen Keller National Center and learned about how to make our events, it was during COVID, so everything was Zoom, but like how to make our events more accessible to all. And especially because we had a focus on intergenerational allyship, knowing that a lot of elderly people may have disabilities, and learning how to make sure that all of our resources and events were accessible, I think was like a key takeaway from our campaign.
Well, thank you all again for this great conversation. And I know it's being recorded and will be stored on the summit kind of platform. So please do share this. And I know Sam just dropped her info in. We dropped in some rare info. We are here to help. We are resources. We would love to talk with y'all, and thank you for joining us. Take care, everyone.